Thank you very much for being with us this beautiful afternoon. We have a program for you that's kind of based on the idea of time, and it's in various ways that it sort of manifests itself. You'll hear pieces that, of course, take you back in time, as all great music does, to a different place, to a different time. But in this first piece we're going to play for you, this overture by Mendelssohn, Calm Sea and Prosperous Voyage, what you'll hear is Mendelssohn's way of playing with the idea of how time feels when it's going by. And so when Mendelssohn was very young, he lived in Berlin with a very well-connected family, and he actually got to hang out with the poet Goethe, and he entertained him sometimes by just playing noise in the background, as Goethe asked for, to sort of distract him. And he later came back to write this piece of music that's based on two of Goethe's poems. One is The Calm Sea, one is The Prosperous Voyage. And he was not the first famous composer to do this either. Beethoven actually had done the same thing. So, and in fact, even in this overture, he mimics a little bit of Beethoven, but mostly he's putting forth his own originality. You'll hear in the first part the absolutely still surface of the sea. And here, time barely moves. You can hardly tell that anything's happening, except the beautiful chords that are gently being played by the orchestra. Finally, the wind is kicked up a little bit. You hear a little bird call that sort of indicates that there's a wind. And you'll hear almost a sailor climbing to the topmast to see what's happening. And the excitement builds up, and this is where the allegro starts of the overture. And it's a celebratory feeling, because being becalmed, while it may be beautiful, is very unproductive, and you're not getting anywhere. So once the wind kicks up, the ship is able to sail. You'll hear a lot of excitement, especially when land is spotted at the end, the fanfares and the trumpets. And then, very imaginatively, at the very last part, the very last couple of moments of the overture, a beautiful sort of amen, sort of surprisingly, because it's very bombastic near the end, but this amen sort of floats above the scene at the end. So Mendelssohn's Calm Sea and Prosperous Voyage.
Thank you.
The next piece we're going to play for you is by Jean-Philippe Rameau. He was the court composer at Versailles for many years. He succeeded Jean-Baptiste Lully, who was the leader and esteemed music director there, who managed to kill himself by wounding himself by his conducting staff on his big toe. What a way to get a job for Rameau. But Rameau was actually already famous then as a writer for keyboard pieces and also as a music theorist. And he was actually one of the first people that really came up with the idea of harmony. I happen to be actually teaching a class here in Arlington at Encore Learning, and we're talking about music theory. And this is one of the few composers who actually first became famous as a music theorist. And he, along with the other members of the encyclopedists in France, came up with this idea of thinking of music vertically and not just horizontally, as had been mostly the fashion. He also presided over, during his life, he actually, I don't think, was interested in all these arguments, but at least three major feuds among musical groups. That's when musicians were actively feuding with each other. It's very peaceful nowadays. I always check behind me, though. Rameau wrote these pieces as incidental music for his sort of ballets, for the operas that he was writing for Versailles. But in this case, you're not just being transported back into the early 1700s to hear what Rameau was doing, but also into the 19th century, because his music was being rediscovered. And Felix Model, who was the arranger of this particular version, you can hear his creativity coming through as well. So what he did is he took a minuet and then a musette, which is kind of a play on a bagpipe sound. You'll hear some drones in the background. And then finally a tambourin, which is a very lively dance that features a kind of low drum, which you'll hear Mark playing later. And it has a kind of pulsing rhythm. But in each of these examples, he didn't just dress out the music with new orchestration. He actually has some creativity in the writing of the pieces too, and you'll hear that come through. It makes for a very exciting orchestral showpiece, but it's also wonderful just because you're kind of getting both perspectives. You're getting that 18th century perspective and that 19th century perspective, and you're hearing it live in the 21st century. So here's the ballet suite arranged by Felix Model of Rameau.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Sorry for the awkward pause. We noticed that a door was open on the side of the auditorium. So, the music we're about to play for you now is by Schubert, written in 1813. He was studying, actually he was still in high school, so to speak, studying with the Italian composer Salieri, who later got a really bad reputation from the movie Amadeus. But actually, he loved Mozart, Salieri did, and so did Schubert. Schubert loved Mozart and Haydn, and these were, in part, the inspiration for the symphony. You can hear it in the music itself. He also came to really worship Beethoven as well. So in 1813, when he was writing this, the first movement starts out with a kind of pompous introduction in the manner of an overture, and then it moves into this extremely bright melody, and Schubert, of course, became renowned for his melodic invention. But one of the interesting things about this opening movement is that introduction sort of just returns in the middle of everything, right in the middle of that movement. The second movement is a very beautiful kind of cantilena, a song-like melody. And this really reminds me of Mozart's 40th symphony. It's in 6-8. It moves back and forth between G major and E minor. It has a kind of ominous counter subject. But you can hear his love of the orchestral sounds that he was experimenting with, and particularly the use of the woodwinds, very imaginative. The third movement, the minuet and trio, here he's contrasting a very forceful minuet theme with a kind of rustic middle section that is the trio. And what he does too is he uses the woodwinds, a very traditional idea, especially the bassoon melody in the trio. And this is really straight out of Haydn. In fact, even the way he scores it with the bassoon with the melody and the violins accompanying along with that sound is part of the sound world of Haydn that he learned from that. And then in the finale, it's a breakneck celebration. A lot going on, especially for the second violins and violas. They look daggers at me sometimes in this piece, but it's a romp. There's a lot of notes, again to borrow from the movie Amadeus. Not too many notes, I hope, but this is really a celebration, astounding from the mind of a 16-year-old. So here again, in terms of time, we're hearing a young person's personality rediscovering, not only learning about the music of the past, but rediscovering his own gift and giving that to us here in the future.
Thank you. Thank you.